Okay, good evening. Then I would like to talk a little bit about online privacy and how we can get it back. We believe in that. What it means to you, but also what it will mean for companies and organizations, what they can benefit from that. I assume that since you are all here on your self-sovereign identity meetup, you are all fully aware what online privacy means, why it's that important. At the same time, I think you are also aware how difficult it is sometimes to explain to other people why they should care about their online privacy, isn't it? So what I do at that time, so where is my, oh yeah, here's my telephone, is I ask those people, could you please take your telephone? Maybe you can do it, this experiment with me. It's not my own experiment, the CEO of Airbnb did it with his audience. So could you please all take your telephone? Could you unlock it? Yeah? Is it unlocked? And now hand it over to the person left of you. This is exactly what happens with your information on the internet every day. So if you meet friends who tell you that they have nothing to hide, ask them for the telephone. On the internet, hundreds of thousands of copies should run. Yeah. Hundreds of thousands of copies with your personal information reside on the internet. And you don't know where all these places are. You don't know what it's used for. But you know one thing for sure, that it can't be up to date everywhere. On the internet we have a handful of organizations that know everything about us. And knowledge is power. So the ones that know you, they have power over you. They can deny your job, refuse you access to the USA, for instance, or just like our own tax services is doing, they can say that you're a default payer just by looking at your Spotify playlist. It's insane. I think that it's scary that this power is in the hands of some commercial organizations. And I believe that just like in the real world, we need a safe place where we can be ourselves. And from where we are able to connect to the rest of the world who we really are on our own terms. And this is why we are investing all our time and money to make our dream come true. We dream of a world, an internet, where each individual is back in control of his own information again. And we also found a way to realize this. So we thought, why don't we turn the data stream completely around and don't store your information over all those hundreds of thousands of places all over the internet, but store it at one central place, which only you can access. It's your own digital shoe safe, which only you have the key, which only you can access, and which only you decide who you give access to. Inside that multiple encrypted digital safe, you can store anything, ranging from real simple addresses to the most complex financial medical records. And the information you do choose to give access to can never be transferred, copied, or sold. And it's always up to date. We know we're not naive. We have a very big goal, and our dot on the horizon is very far away. But we know that we can achieve it. So we've plotted out a roadmap to work along. First of all, we are talking to companies, big companies, and we invite them to join the founding foundation for the development of Shields. We're talking to a lot of broad mix of organizations and companies, since we want to stay independent. And we're talking to a lot of them, they are interested. And at the same time, we are now setting up pilots to validate and to learn already. And to help these companies comply to GDPR and PSD2. In these pilots that we are now setting up, we are learning and validating. And we know that we have four pillars that are important for the success of SLUSH. First of all, techniques, of course, is really important. I don't have a technical background. We have technical people on board. Technique is really important, it's the basics, of course. But at the same time, we know in the end, we will manage, we will achieve this, we will make it work. Not only by the people that we have on board, but all the developments that are taking place right now. We'll come back to that later on. But technique itself won't make SLUSH work. Legal and compliance is also really important. Valeria talked about it. What regulations and legal issues are out there? They differ per country, differ per branch. So how do we comply to all the regulations? Important to find out. Third, UX. How do we develop something this new, never been done before? It has to be really simple and intuitive to work with. And at the same time, you as a user needs to be very, you need to feel that it's really secure, it's really private. So how we manage this? And last but not least, communications is really important. Of course, with the final customers, people who are going to use SLUSH. We know from different investigations that people really do want to have the control over their own information again. 80-90% of the people. So that's not each issue. But at the same time, we know that people are still not acting on this. So how do we take them to the whole process, because we won't have SLUSH available in the short term, that will be a process. So how do we take all these users, but also the companies that we're working with, the developers, how do we take them through that process? So communication is really a very important issue. We are working, working with some companies. First of all, in a consortium with ICTU, that's the development partner of the government, and KPN, Rabobank, Chamber of Commerce, and this will be applied to the blockchain. And separate from that, we are doing pilots with the Volksbank, that's SNS and ASN, Dutch bank here. And it's a really important partner for us to work along with, because this bank has really in its own mission set that they want to have the control of the information back to the customers again. So that's really cool to work with. And also Vivat, known from Real and Zwitserleven, we are working with them to set up pilots. And at the same time, we hope to close an agreement with an energy company and a telco coming months, hopefully. So how will we actually make this work? You must be curious. And at the same time, we are still curious too, because the techniques behind this is huge. Yeah, on the techniques, Henk already told, we have different issues. Identification and authorization is an important issue. Developments are taking place in that area. Authorization is an important issue. Developments are taking place at this moment. And the storage layer beneath that is also important. So how do we develop something from a centralized system as it is right now, but as soon as possible to a distributed system, of course. And we look into IPFS and Bitdust for that part. We have our first basic beta version online. That's only meant, I would say, to show the core principles of SLUSH. And from that basic beta version, we will be further developing SLUSH in the coming periods, years, probably. Yeah. since on the different issues that we foresee that are important for the success, the identification authorization, developments are still taking place. So it hasn't been finalized and set yet. But we want to combine all those different parts, and that's where we come in. How do we combine those parts and present a dashboard over it, that it will be user-friendly and able for people to use it. You could think that the companies will never participate with an initiative like Sluice. They will never, I meet people who say they will never give the data of the customers out of their hands, back to the customers again. But also for them, there's a lot to gain. So what we thought is we have to build Sluice in steps. First of all, we are now redeveloping that first Sluice safe, in which you can store your information and you can disclose it to other people and keep control over it. But at the same time, then from that Sluice safe, you can see what a company or organization, what information they have of you. That's step one. And they need to do so with the new legislation, GDPR, coming up. So that's first help for them. In the second stage, you will then be able to correct and adapt that information that this company still has of you. In the third stage, you will then be able to manage that information. So the email address that that company has of you, they can use it for sending you the monthly invoice, but not for their newsletter. Or with just switching it on, they can use it to send you your monthly email newsletter as well. And in the last stage, and finally, that information from that company will be transferred in steps to your own digital Sluice safe. And we've been talking to the Volksbank about it, and they think, okay, the first information that can be transferred probably could be your contact information. And in later stage, other more complex information will be transferred as well. So there you see that your Sluice safe also fills itself with information from companies and organizations. And from there, you will be able to disclose that information to companies as well. And now you can see where the benefit for companies comes in. Because this way, they have access to rich, up-to-date customer information. But only if they can tell you what the added value for you is. It's not about value for money anymore. It's about value for data. And you had a quote like that as well in your presentation, Lang. So if a company can explain to you what the added value of sharing information is, disclosing information is, I might even share more information with them. But only if I decide that the added value is of value for me. So where it comes down to for companies is they can build or have to build a valuable relationship built on trust. It's about informing you beforehand what they are going to do with your information and if you agree on that. And at the same time, if the Sluice system is fully operational, they don't have that information at their premises anymore. So no more hassle about keeping the databases up to date, keeping it secure, data breaches, and all the costs that come with that, and keeping it up to date, etc. So, yeah.
Can I ask a question?
Of course.
So how do you make sure they don't secretly store a copy of the data once you've given it?
Yeah, or transfer it to someone else. Or if disclose it to someone else.
Yeah, that's where technology comes in, and that's where what technology has been working on at the moment. In the first stage, we have to do it on agreement.
Who's auditing them? Who's auditing them?
There are already companies setting up on these schemes about sharing information through notes, etc. So that's a system based on trust. Take a look at Qi. Why? They've built a trust scheme And the pilot, one of the pilots that we are doing, will be doing with the Volksbank, is built on that scheme as well.
So, I don't know if I got it right. So, you have Facebook, let's say, that owns some of your data.
Yeah.
Related to you, and you're gonna ask Facebook to pinky promise that they'll give you the data, and then they'll delete it because she was asked.
What she's saying is there's gonna be auditors, like Big Four, similarly.
Yeah,
specialize in auditing these companies
then
to make sure that they actually have
auditors.
But you mentioned Facebook, of course, and I foresee that Facebook will be at the later parties to work with the sludge. So we aim, of course, at first to work with companies that that think that the online privacy of the customers is of importance. And there are enough of these companies to start with. And of course, there are also some companies still hesitating, well, should we, shouldn't we, etc. But they will come as the first set, as a success. So and that's where the others come in. I see a lot of questions already. So maybe if I finish my presentation first, maybe some questions will be answered. And if there are still some questions left, I'll be happy to explain them after. Is that okay? So okay, but you see that there are benefits for companies as well, and that this is a reason why they are willing to participate with us. Okay, but who's going to make this happen? Together with Techie Bob, we're the founders of Sluice. But in the meantime, our team grew a lot with Bert Maurice. He's also an expert on techniques. Peter, Mitzi, Laszlo are part of our core team. But 1.5 weeks ago, we had a first founders meetup, and almost 50 people joined that meetup and wanted to participate and work with us, cooperate, share expertise, knowledge, network, etc., to further grow Sluice. And we share our mission with great visionaries in the area, like Jaya Balu, KPN, CISO, 2015. No CISO, Chief Information Security Officer. She's really famous. So we are very happy that she is on our board of advice, also a Dutch slide, sorry. Board of advice, it says. And together with Mark Wesseling. And also people at this level, they catch on, and they understand what we are doing. I also found out, if I'm talking to companies, I need to speak at a higher level of management. They understand that this is the way we are working towards. People at this level, they catch on. And they tell me this is the way to protect our data and that of our children. So I had a small message from Jaya, but there is no sound, so we continue. She said that Sluice is the way to protect our data and still be free on the internet and use all the possibilities of the internet. Because the internet has a lot of possibilities to use. But this way we can use it safely. Together, I say we can change the internet. That's why we are making the software available in open source. We are building a community, a worldwide cooperative, where each Sluice user is co-owner of Sluice itself. So to ensure that Sluice will be and always remains that independent, trusted third party. So only together we can do it. We have to combine and join forces. So if you can participate in whatever way, I invite you to join us and make Sluice a success, because our dreams will come true. With Sluice, you. And only you decide who knows what about you. Okay, questions?
Well, to follow up on his questions, I still don't understand how you ensure that like a company like Volksbank will make sure that it doesn't secretly make a copy of the data I give it to them, or that I agree that they can use? How do I ensure that?
In the last stage, we hope to make that available in techniques, and that they can't keep secretly copies. In the first stage,
if they need my email address, to send me something.
Mm-hmm.
I give them my email address, and so they have all have my email address. And
yeah, but once it's stored in your own SLU safe, they can use it for sending you that mail, but don't have to keep it at their own in their own.
But they can, right? If they want.
Yeah, they can. But there is no use for them anymore. And if SLUS is fully operational, there's a lot of them for them to lose if they breach on the afspraak die we have
made.
So,
you can encrypt the email address, right? So you can say Volkswagen, you can use, for example, use, you can say, you can use my, like, you can write me an email, send it to me, and then they don't even have the email address, they just have the...
Yeah, we have been thinking about, we have been thinking about making Schluss mails, which doesn't combine to the Schluss, exactly. But,
So, I'm
not a technical expert, so I can't dive really deep into techniques, but I know that on the different parts that we have foreseen to be very important for the success of SLUS, that developments are taking place in the market right now, and they are not available from now on. So until that time, we have to work with negotiations and agreements. So once you breach such an agreement, you're out forever. And
approximately how many companies are we talking about that have your data? If we're talking about hundreds?
Hundreds of thousands. So we can't get them back immediately, that's for one, and we can't get them back all at once, or maybe even for a bigger term.
But if you can't get them back, then the whole value proposition of Schluss.
Yeah, but at the same time, your information changes every time.
You don't change your date of birth, you don't change your name.
No.
At least, I know, normally you don't change your name.
No, correct.
You might move, you might change your bank account, you might get a new driver.
Yeah, of course, there are certain things in, that will never change. And maybe in the end we have, we are thinking about making Schluss work, if we could develop a tool which shows you at least where your information all over the internet is. And that might be a way to create awareness. But
are you afraid of there are other companies that would not benefit by this, but would be blocked by Schluss, that they will
I don't think that I don't foresee. I see you. I'll come back later. Yeah.
America is not.
No, we're not afraid of that because I think there's a movement going on, and the movement will make companies change their way of working with personal information. And some companies are already aware of that and following what we are doing. Those are the companies that we are talking to and are interested in setting up pilots or even fund us in the founding organization, Jaya Blue, for instance. And that group is growing, and that group will give the momentum to make other companies switch to another data strategy. And of course, Google's Facebook, they will be at the last stage.
Thank you. I'm gonna give you some positive feedback and ask you some stuff. I appreciate that it's open source, so that's quite important.
Yeah.
That's great.
It's basic, huh? Yeah, for us we...
So pretty much like where does blockchain go? So my interest is, and my point of view is purely directed from that perspective. So you mentioned IPFS, which is not innately encrypted as a form of distribution. I don't know your technical ability or knowledge, so I'm not really criticise you based on that, but I would recommend for you to look into that or ask your team. Because IPFS, as I said, is not encrypted in A-Base. So if you're looking at that as a form of distribution, it's not a very wise thing to do, but it is nonetheless a good way of distribution. But because you're dealing with people's private data, you may need to add another layer to
Sure.
The other aspect was that you mentioned that you want to eventually turn it from centralized to distributed.
Mm-hmm.
For me, I guess I'm a bit puzzled, why not just start distributed? You know, because in that case, you're already showing people the intent rather than saying, oh, we're going to start. Like, sometimes it's just a proof of concept or whatever it is, then I guess it's kind of fine, but you can always start, you know, distributed to begin with to really show people on a small scale what you can do at a distributed level, rather than, you know, bring it on in a centralized and then say, yeah, later we'll make it distributed, which making the people's ability to have trust in the system. The other aspect is who really stores this. I mean, you know, the concept of blockchain is to remove the middleman, and you're asking to be the middleman. And that, for me, is, again, a bit puzzling because, you know, if you are going to do that, you have a lot of responsibility, especially if you are going to undertake storing such critical data as not just one form of data. So you're not just dealing, for example, with social media, you're dealing with medical records, personal data, bank information, a lot of other aspects. In India, they already did this for 1 billion people, they reached it. And for me, that's very worrying because in that case, it was kind of like this cool optional thing. It came about, people could have opted into it, and then the government was like, no, it's mandatory. If you want to open the bank, then you have to go through the system now. And you know, these things can kind of be turned, so you kind of have a responsibility. I just saw the eyes on the other things just got scared. But never mind. So yeah, I would just really consider these aspects because you may not think it now, and later maybe when you have a user database, it might be turned against you, or some sort of regulation might kick into place where, due to anti-money laundering, anti-terrorism, some bullshit like that, you may have to open these gateways to sort of government agencies or other things. And you know, a lot of people don't consider these aspects because they think, oh, you know, we're just going to build it like this, but it's
now, for us, it's really I'm not the real technical expert, so I can't answer all of your questions. But I would love to bring you in contact with Maurice, who will be happy to talk to you about it. Really, so I would love to do that. But for Sluice, it's really important that you and only you decide who knows what about you. So it will be even that way that we as Sluice don't even know who our customers are. If you decide not to share any information with Sluice, the company itself.
At a fundamental level, that's beautiful, but you know, they have these things called policies which they don't allow you to, especially with the US. So if you have customers from the US, you're not legally allowed to do such things.
Yeah, and there we have to find out how we can apply to the core of the law and maybe even make Sluice work as I'm telling you right now, that black white. So that won't make it easy, but this is at the same time the core principle Sluice. So we know that we have to find out and have to do a lot of work to combine all those things, but that's at the same time the core basic principle of Sluice.
Yeah.
But if you
can clone it and
If you don't plan to identify your users, can I impersonate someone else?
You can?
If I can impersonate someone else.
Impersonate?
Yeah. If I provide someone else's IP.
No, because at the same time, we need to make sure that you can open only one Sluice safe. And from that safe,
what is the identifier that's safe based on?
The identifier has to be an external party, but maybe, or maybe a bank. But at the same time, it could be for your birth certificate only that you are identified with only one safe. And at the same time, from that one safe, you can disclose information an anonymous way, maybe, or like Hank told, the various virtual identities that you have. So disclose different parts of information, or maybe anonymous or pseudonymous information to other parties, or for investigation, or whatever.
Apart from Frust, this is an area of research of many initiatives in the world. I think we have like 20 or 25 operating in this field, in this area. And for me, it would be much more a question, how should we do things to not get into the problems that you just mentioned before? Because we might have this knowledge that you say the team could use to proceed in a way that we don't do the wrong things.
Yeah.
They might easily find pitfalls in the concept that you pronounce, but it would be nice if we correct the pitfalls and give the information to her, which needs to build it up.
That's what we need, since you identify correctly. We have a lot of challenges to come over, but we think that we can manage and overcome all those challenges if we really work together. That's my call wherever I'm coming. I meet initiatives sometimes on the on this own area, and I always give them my hand, let's cooperate and do this together, since this is this big. Nobody can achieve this by himself. So with developers, with technical experts, legal experts, UX experts, but also with companies and organizations that share this same vision, let's do this together. Only then we can achieve this. So if there's anybody here who wants to join, please do so. Yeah, you want to join?
Yeah. One thing that I thought was under, there's also a large movement, of course, in law that corporations are not always allowed to do certain things without data anymore. European law has changed last year.
Yeah, and will change even further.
And will change. There is also a movement again towards larger privacy. So there's one thing to say, how are you going to do it? The other side is, if they do it, they can be fined terribly high. I've talked to a few companies who are interested. The fines for data breach are going up.
Yeah,
so,
extremely.
That's the incentive, I would say.
Yeah.
It's also a good one.
Yeah, it is. It is. I mentioned that that one shortly.
Yeah.
But the companies that I'm willing to participate right now are those who foresee the privacy of the customers.
Yeah.
Because their intention is different than the efficiency reason.
There's ideology and there's fear.
Yeah, and the companies that I want to work with in this stage are the ideology. Ideology.
We have time for two more questions.
I saw you.
Yeah, well, I think it's a great initiative, but I do have one important question, and that's, are you planning on monetizing on?
Yeah,
how are you going to fund this?
That's a real good question. In the end, it's really simple. The one who pays decides. And if you are going to decide who are you going to disclose your information to, you are going to be the one who's paying for it. So as a Schluss user, you will be paying. And at the same time, we want a yearly fee. And at the same time, we want to have that fee as low as possible, since everybody should be able to afford Schluss. But we know that we can, we are building this cooperative, and the aim of the cooperative, cooperatie, is not about making large profits, it's about keeping personal online privacy. But yeah, we can't only ask money to Schluss users if we have something to offer them. So what we are doing right now is setting up these pilots. These pilots are, we are paid for these pilots with these companies, and we are setting up this foundation for the development of Schluss. And we ask 10 companies, broad range of companies, telcos, banks, insurance companies, Internet of Things, medical, government, education, well, 10 different companies to come in that founding foundation. And together with them, we will develop the first part of SLUSH, which is good enough to ask SLUSH users to pay for it. And at the same time, these companies will offer SLUSH to their customers as well. So in this way, we have a bigger range of customers to start with.
So, but your payment information could link you to your...
Oh, the payment information of you as customer of SLUSH user.
Well, it's a follow-up question.
Yeah.
Yeah, it could link you to your real world.
Yeah, so we have to invent something on that as well. Yeah.
You could use Monero.
Monero.
You could also say that companies that want to use the data would pay you as a SLUSH user.
Yeah,
and with that
I've heard that one before, and we are still considering that, but we're not very eager to start that, because there goes the same. The one who pays decides, and we don't want companies to decide what's going to happen with SLUSH. So we need to be very strict on that. So we keep it in our minds, but...
Yeah. No, but I don't mean that the companies pay SLUSH, but they pay the user.
Yeah, we have thought about that as well.
Generates the funds to pay SLUSH.
Yeah. Yeah, true, we have thought about that as well. But there comes an ethical question up. Because we want to start with SLUSH to really bring online privacy to customers, to people again. And if at the same time I tell you, well, but you can earn money with your data, well, I believe that there's part of people in the Netherlands, in Europe, in the world, who think, okay, now I can earn a lot of money with giving my data away in a way and sharing it and selling it. And that's something that we want to prevent and help these people not to do it, to be careful with it.
Last. So please keep discussing.
Yeah.